Welcome back. All good. Welcome to the Breaking Bread podcast. Obviously, I've got myself, Francis, Sis, and the brother here.
Yeah, kia ora, my name's Brody. Welcome back. Got a guest on today. Someone very cool.
Very close to myself and just family. So first of all, just want to welcome Willie.
Thank you.
What's
up, man? First episode?
Yeah, first one of many. One of the first episodes that we have on at the moment. We'll just dive straight into it, eh? Did you want to tell us who you are and where you come from?
Yeah, sweet. So, tala for everyone. My name's William. Son of the 09, son of the 685.
Son of Nigel.
Nigel and Tina. just grew up in, I guess, grew up around Grey Lynn, grew up around Mount Roskill. Only child, so grew up with a lot of family, a lot of cousins. So, yeah, that's a little bit about myself. Went to New Windsor Primary, Buckhouse Bay Intermediate, then finished my schooling up in Auckland Grammar. Yeah. The one and only. Not on scholarship.
Shout out to the boys on scholarship. We'll just get into our five questions. Got some five questions for you.
Yeah, so we got a quick five questions for Willie to sort of break the ice and get into a little bit. So, Oos, who's the best player you've ever played with?
Best player?
Ever.
Reeks.
Rico?
Yep.
Rico Ioane.
Okay.
Sorry, Aki.
Sorry, Aki.
Who's the grubbiest player you've ever played with?
Oh,
yourself.
Besides yourself.
Besides myself, Tosta.
Ooh.
Tosta. Danny Tostella.
What? When we talk about grubby, like what's some of the stuff that he does?
Short man syndrome.
Like got anger management problem?
Anger management.
Yeah. Is he the type to like start fights on the field?
He's the type to start it. But not finish it. Oh, the start classic Westie.
The starter then start backing up.
Mean. Who's the smelliest?
Oh. Bro, it has to be one of the white boys, man.
You know what? Honestly, I've heard that quite a few times. It's like everyone thinks that the Balangis and that are very clean.
Balangis are the worst.
They got the maddest BOA. BO of doom.
But in the sporting arena, like a lot of people that have said, like, yeah, like some of the white boys are pretty like grody and they're pretty dirty.
Yeah.
Who would you give that title to?
Probably one of the boys that I play with in America. His name's Jack Escar. Grubbiest dude. I walked into his apartment the other day before I came back.
Yeah.
Dishes everywhere. Blankets still not bloody folded, no washing, nothing.
Are you a clean person yourself?
I'm not the cleanest, but I'm clean.
Clean enough.
Compared to that dude.
Yeah, I mean, next one. Who's the funniest?
Funniest person I played with? Little wise guy.
Wise guy.
He's not very wise
guy.
He's not a wise guy.
He's not a wise person.
And who should have made it but hasn't got quite kicked on in their rugby career?
Other than myself. there's a lot of boys like that, man.
Who's one that you thought like that bring like as soon as you think of that question, it just pops up in your head of like one person that should have made it, but whatever reason didn't.
But one throwback dude is probably, you remember Shem?
Shem Tatupu. Yeah.
That's an oldie but a goodie, man.
Bro, he went on to the AFL, eh?
He went to AFL, yeah. AFL. Straight out of school.
Well, I think he's still there.
I think he's still playing AFL. I seen a video of him the other day.
Has he Muscly or bigger?
I don't know. You tell me. that's one dude, man.
He was a freak.
He was talented, man. He was the next Israel Folau.
Yeah, dude.
Tall, lanky, fast, strong,
athletic too.
Athletic.
He was Shaq in that. Like, is that Shaq good in that year?
Yeah.
It's
a good man.
I remember him. I think it was him and Denny Solomon.
And Denny. Denny kicked on.
Yeah, but then he ended up kicking on. He
played for England.
He's still killing. And then he went back to league. He's gone to league, eh?
Oh, is he gone to league?
I think he went.
Because he was here for the Highlanders and then.
Ah, true.
But Shim, yeah, Shim, man.
Yeah.
He was a freak.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about there. Anyways, yeah, so we'll just talk about how did you get into rugby?
Since I was young, man, I played at Roskill District back when. Back when that was a thing.
That's around the corner from me.
Yeah, Roskill District. When I was about 7, 8, and then made my way to Ponsonby and then been there ever since. But just got into rugby through the grandpa.
Yeah. Have you obviously your dad coming from league, have you ever had a dabble or a muck around in league? Or have you played league at all?
I've never played league at all.
At all?
Even juniors?
Not even juniors.
True.
The only time I ever kind of dabbled in rugby league was when I went over school holidays and I went to train with St. George Dragons. And that's when Wayne Bennett was the coach. I think they won it that year with Mark Gasnier and all that.
Oh, yeah. That was
2010?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was 10, around that time because I was fourth form. Yeah, 2010.
Yeah, that's right.
And then I went over holidays and then they wanted to sign me for SG Ball.
Yeah.
Or what is it? Jersey Flake?
Nah, SG Ball.
Yeah. So they would have put me through school and all that, but mum didn't want me to go. So I ended up staying and ended all my years at Auckland Grammar.
Your mum, obviously, Auntie Tina, shout out to Auntie Tina, rugby fanatic or would you say league?
Sport fanatic.
Just sports in general.
Sports in general.
Yeah.
Whatever son's playing, whatever her daughter's playing, just whatever family.
Follow along. Just
sport fanatic.
Oh yeah, so would you say your mum or your dad had the biggest influence over you playing rugby?
Mum and grandpa.
Did your dad ever want you to sort of transition to league and give league a crack?
Mum has kind of said to do it.
Yeah,
I've kind of thought of doing it just to give it a try. Yeah. Say that I've done it before, my legs don't work anymore. But
hey, there's a spot next year at PWO, man.
Well, that's the only club I'll go to.
We're looking for a half. Need to get me back out on the centres.
You might have to jump on the wing. But speaking, like you just said, you attended Auckland Grammar.
Yep.
How was that going through school and doing all that, playing rugby through school? So you want to speak a little bit about that?
Yeah, so Auckland Grammar was pretty diverse school. Very different. When I was at school, there was probably only, I want to say, 30 Islanders.
Yeah,
true.
Back then. Nowadays, it's probably about 100, 150 of them.
Yeah.
All on scholarship. But, it was something different. I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
An all-boys school. Just got to hang out with different nationalities, you know?
Yeah.
Mm. With some Chinese people, some Asians, some Indians, some Balangis. So, kind of helped me as a person after Auckland Grammar.
After school.
Being able to connect with people.
Yeah.
How was like the first of, did you would have played first 15?
Yeah.
How was like that? Because obviously Auckland Grammar is a pretty well-known first 15 school. How was like being in that environment and obviously playing first 15 for Auckland?
First 15 at Auckland Grammar is a big thing, man. Like they named the squad in front of all, the whole school
at assembly or something.
At assembly in the morning.
Yeah.
So you rock up, you know when the team's gonna get named.
Yeah.
And you rock up to school and you're nervous. You're nervous, man. And
I remember. Do they tell you beforehand or it's just on the day?
On the day, you find out when you walk into assembly. Well, that's how I found out.
Yeah.
And then they pretty much just name the list after the main assembly goes into the, obviously the sports, and they talk about the sports, and then, all right, your first 15 for. 2011 or 2012.
You guys get up and go in front, or just name, put your name.
They just name, and then your boys sit next to you, just give you a handshake. And one
shots.
Or if you didn't make it, unlucky.
Oh.
Pretty much. And then, man, it's just a prestigious school for rugby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if it still is, but it's got the most All Blacks. Yes. A lot of history. Just if you walk into Auckland Grammar, all over the walls, man, a lot of history.
Yeah.
Not only rugby, but just sports in general and academics. Yeah. It's like going to Hogwarts.
Because for those of you that don't know what Auckland Grammar is like, it's in a pretty wealthy area, eh?
Yeah.
And it's pretty, what's the word? It's not, like, not anyone can go there.
Yeah. It's pretty.
Let's just put it this way. Most of the islanders that go there are on scholarship.
Yeah, either on scholarship or their parents are doing well.
Yeah, their parents are doing well.
Yeah.
So you're not going to get, like your lower class people that just rock up there. Unless, can you just go there if you live in zone?
Yeah.
So if you're in zone, you're just automatically.
If you're in zone, you're good.
Yeah.
But if not, you're out of zone.
But not many islanders live in zone.
Yeah, it'd be an expensive zone to live in, eh?
Mount Eden.
Yeah, a million plus around there.
So that's why all the islanders go down to St. Peter's.
Yeah.
St. Peter's.
St. Peter's is just the school straight.
Over the bridge.
On the other side of the bridge, eh?
Of the state highway one.
And they're your biggest rivals?
Nah. They think they are. They think they are.
We'll talk a little bit about you at secondary school. What's some names that you got to play with coming through the grades? We know, obviously, who you're real close with, but you wanna name drop some people that you got the opportunity to play with at school? Or even against?
Yeah, even just watching. When I was young, my first 2 years at school, Connie Harrell was the midfielder.
Mm. Yeah.
Connie Harrell was there. Kurt Eklund, who's the Blues hooker now.
Hooker, yep.
Then I got the privilege to play with Aki.
Yeah, shout out to Aki.
Aki. Shout out to Aki. Reeks. Shooter, Sean Stevenson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we had a good team.
Not a bad team.
Yeah. We had a stacked team and a lot of workhorse boys.
Yeah.
Mm.
Those Balangi farmers that live in the hostel.
Honestly, just tough dudes.
Just tough dudes, man.
They even have those guys in league, like the farm boys in Aussie.
Mm, the country boys.
They just smack you. Or if you smack them, like they just get up and run straight back at you. And
just laugh. Just laugh.
They're the worst people to play against, but the best people to play with, I think. So.
100.
Did you guys win it?
Nah. What happened? We lost to St. Ken's both years.
Who's in St.
Ken's? They were stacked back in those
who
years,
it?
Eh?
Who was
that when Sully?
Sully.
TJ. Was that TJ?
TJ.
Sam Nock in that, eh?
Sam Nock. Johnny Faoli. Finlay Christie.
Fuck.
Sione Mafileo.
Damn.
You want me to keep going? Or?
The whole Blues team, eh? Fuck.
Right. You want to know about buying a team? There you go.
I put them on scholarship and we'll take them.
Pride over money.
Yeah. Just on that, obviously you've had been playing rugby your whole life and all that, but what's been your biggest challenges but on and off the field that you've faced I guess now that you're a bit older?
Yeah, you're old coot.
I am getting old, man. Probably off the field's injuries.
Yeah.
Injuries are the worst when you're playing sport.
What's some of the injuries that you've had?
Done my ACL twice, MCL, shoulder, and just a few niggly ones, you know? Those are probably the hardest ones, the niggly ones that just
keep coming just back just linger and stuff around.
Right? Yeah. So those are my ankles, and then just pretty much my knees still lingering, but it's way better now. But probably my two ACLs were the worst.
Just long.
Yeah. Long, grindy, going through a lot of mental,
mental battles and
mental battles
and stuff. What about on the field?
Challenges on the field.
Just before you say that, I've played against you before in rugby. I think once, and I've always thought like that game where I played you. I thought, oh, like this fellow will kick on, like surely. Yeah, yeah. And I think, I know you'll probably speak about obviously not getting to teams and all that. But yeah, for me personally, I've played against you once and I thought, oh, fuck this.
Was that up north?
Yeah, that was up north. It was like you played for Auckland Bees and I was in.
What was the ground?
Oh, I can't even.
Was that when Wise Guy was your first wife?
Yeah, Wise was playing. Yeah,
he was your first wife.
Yeah, so, what's been for you that the your biggest challenge?
On the field?
Yeah, on the field.
Bro, exactly that. Just getting compared to others. Yeah. Just challenges of, oh, he's, you know, he's doing this. Why can't you do this? Just outside pressure, I guess, on the field.
Yeah.
Pressures from other people. It can be an off-field thing as well, but I usually feel it on the field, and then you're trying to prove yourself on the field, do too much, and then...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is that like an expectation thing?
Yeah.
Like obviously, you're always your hardest critic, that you always put big expectations on yourself.
Yeah.
So, like, is that what you found was some of the biggest challenges on the field?
Yeah. Was a lot of critics, and myself included, but... I guess I got over it. There was this quote I heard maybe 5-6 years ago.
Mm.
Comparison is the thief of joy.
Yeah.
Mm.
Comparing yourself to others, and not only everyday life, not in rugby, but also everyday life. You know?
Yeah, 100.
This guy's making this amount of sales. Why can't you do that?
Mm.
You know, this guy's lifting this much weight. Why can't you do that? Yeah. So nowadays, I don't really compare myself to anyone other than myself.
Yeah,
hard.
If you're better today than you were yesterday,
that's all that matters.
You're good, man. That's all that matters.
Yeah, 100.
What was I gonna say about that? It's I forgot what I was gonna say. In regards to that, I just had that train of thought, and then when you had carried on, I was just thinking that's what I was gonna say is social media. Do you think nowadays with social media, obviously I can post anything I want to post, and anyone can see it that follows me. So a lot of people compare themselves.
Yeah.
But in reality, like we can post heaps of money, but we can just zoom in on it, look like $1 million and just say, oh, making bank.
Yeah,
yeah.
Exactly.
What's your thoughts around that?
Man, social media is taking over the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And a lot of comparisons within people kind of compare themselves to others.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't look good in this photo.
Yeah.
I don't want to post this because I've posted too many photos.
Yeah.
I've got too many stories on.
Yeah.
I still do that. I hate posting heaps of stories, but I know people think like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it kind of holds them back from just finding joy and putting that photo up, you know? Mm. And, man, people just got to enjoy life every day, one step at a time.
Life's a bit too short these days.
Yeah, man. After the last month?
Yeah.
Yeah, life's too short, man. You see a lot of young people passing away. Yeah,
mm. Yeah. No, I mean, just on that, your challenges on and off the field, what's some of the, looking back, what did you do to overcome those sort of barriers and all that?
How did you deal with
it? Yeah, how did you deal with all those challenges on and off the field?
Let's talk about your injuries first. How did you overcome dealing with your injuries? Because off-field stuff, you said, your ACL is a long process. How did you deal with stuff like that?
Finding comfort in friends and that.
Mm-hmm.
But I will say my first ACL, where I done it, and I didn't know, that was my first big injury. Didn't know the process, didn't know what was going on, didn't know what to expect. And then kind of went through a spiral of depression and where I just started looking for that shooter.
Right. Hold up, we'll just wait for it to go over. Oh, see, this is real life podcast. No studio, no nothing. Straight in the
cheers
gym.
Shout out to BossFit. Cheers, Kale.
Sponsor us.
Yeah, carry on. Because that was good. You started going deep spiral.
Yeah, deep spiral, deep depression, just because I didn't know what to expect. It's kind of like someone taking away the thing that you love the most for 12 months. That's how long my process was. 12 months. So I turned to drinking, turned to... just trying to get myself away from thinking about what I had to do to rehab or get better. And then that was a big challenge in itself. then once I kind of could see the light at the end of the tunnel,
yeah,
then I just started finding, you know, the close boys and just hanging out with mates and just kind of finding joy within myself again and started getting excited about rugby again.
Like a return.
Return. Mm. Get back to training, start running. Oh, yeah, sweet. Starting to feel good. Then, so pretty much just family, friends, just surrounding myself with people. You know, people are going to have their phases when they get depressed and go through things. But everyone deals with things differently, just like when someone passes away, you know, people deal with things differently. And I guess that's how I dealt with it. And then when I had my second one, I knew what to expect.
Yeah.
I knew what I needed to do. I knew the process. I knew how long I was going to be in it for. Yeah. So my mind was clearer.
Mm.
You know, my mind was clear. I knew what I needed to tick off to make sure that by the end of this 10, 11 months, I'll be good to go. And my knee hasn't played up since, touch wood. But, yeah, I guess small circles, man.
Yeah,
small circles are the best.
Because I think I was, I know I was part of the process of when you've done your ACL and all that. And,
yeah,
like, I seen you after you have done it. When was the first time you done it? Where was it at?
First one I did was out at Manukau.
How old were you when you done Manukau. Your first one?
20.
So young, eh?
20. And I was supposed to get a 20s World Cup that year.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was like the week before camp.
That would have just shattered you, eh?
Shattered me, man. Because I kind of tweaked it. And then I had 4 weeks off. Physio said, yeah, sweet. Have 4 weeks off. Just strengthen your leg. Did that for 4 weeks. Came back, first game back, boom. Just kind of hyperextended my knee. And then went to the doctors. Then they said, yeah, pretty much fully tore my ACL.
Yeah.
And then I knew that's when I couldn't go World Cup because it was in, I think it was in Manchester that year. And I was gutted. Because
yeah.
The year that before that was here in New Zealand. Yeah. I was like keen to travel, but couldn't travel.
Because that's a ACL is a, it can be if you let it be a lonely process. See?
Yeah.
Like when you go into to do your rehab and all that, it's basically you by yourself.
Yeah.
Unless you have someone else that's tagging along, or unless you have, you know, someone that comes along to your rehab, it's basically all by yourself.
Yeah.
And that's where those dark times happen.
Yeah. Pretty much any injury, I feel like you're just isolated from everyone.
Yeah.
Even happens in team environments. You hear about people getting injured and then they're on their own timetable away from the boys.
We spoke about that hard.
Yeah. Which I think is which I kind of question sometimes.
Because,
You know, that's where you get your energy from. That's where you get the good feel of being in the team is gymming and, you know, being around the boys. But when you're injured, it's kind of like you're in your own place.
Yeah.
Just you one-on-one with the trainer, you one-on-one with the physio, just doing your own thing. Some people might like that,
yeah.
But I know for myself, I enjoy training with the boys. And
because
there's days where you wake up and you're like, why am I doing this? Especially when you're injured. Why am I doing this?
Did it mean you speak about that? Is like say, for example, like how you get isolated in like your own rehab or whatever. It's then that's when like that mental mindset can sit in, because like me and you might have done our ACLs together,
yeah,
and then I'm recovering faster than you are,
yeah.
So now you're like, bro, why
comparing?
Back to comparing. So like, why is he healing faster than me, or why is he running before I'm running? And then we start to like, sort of, I don't know if you start, but like for me, like that's where I think like shortcuts start to happen.
Exactly.
Yeah. Like and then shortcuts become in your rehab, because I know that if you get injury and you're around the boys, like around the games, and like this guy had it when we played on the Wednesday night, is like you get itchy feet,
yeah,
and you want to be a part of it, so you start like making
rushing
yourself. And you know what that does. So you want to tell us about how you got over, like how you dealt with some of the stuff on the field, like expectations and all of that stuff.
I'm a pretty chilled person.
Chilly vibes.
I'm chilly vibes since I was at high school, man. I'm just a go with the wind, anything goes type person. So the way I dealt with that was kind of just finding joy within myself, finding joy doing, like, being there in the first 15, being there for Ponsonby, just training, being able to run. Because, man, I think you think about it now, someone like Fats, man, can just go like that. Or Mose Masoi, just one run can change everything. So just being in the moment, in the present, enjoying enjoying running, enjoying being able to use my legs. So that's how I
dealt with it,
yeah.
Oh.
Must be coming around here.
He's over here.
He's doing the podcast.
He's hiding in the gym.
Just being, what would you say? Just being grateful for what you have?
Yeah, being grateful. That's our saying with our boys, just, are you grateful?
Yeah.
Mm.
Are you grateful? Even if it's, gee, why are you giving me only one bite?
Yeah.
Grateful?
The smallest thing, eh?
The smallest thing.
Mean.
Just be grateful, man.
Yeah.
So that's how I got over my injury. I had a lot of help from outside people. So that second ACL, I was sweet to play, but I wasn't mentally.
Mm.
And we were talking about it on Tuesday. Yeah. I had to go see a mentalist for about a psychologist for about a month. Mm. So the first meeting that I had with her was just a sheet of paper, questions, 1 to 10, and just circle the number. Just read the question and circle the number. And questions were like, how does your knee feel? Circle of 7. How is your body feeling to get back into rugby? 7, so on and so forth. And then after that, kind of opened my mind to I'm actually not that ready.
Yeah.
Because I'm physically ready, but I'm not mentally ready.
Yeah.
We were talking about it on Tuesday about strapping and having that mental battle going into a game, thinking, oh, I need to favor my other side because this side's not good. I can't run as fast because I don't want to do anything.
Did you you see a lot of boys when they do the ACLs, like when they come back, you just sort of know that they're not the same. Like, you know, they're struggling to try step off that foot again and all that stuff. Did you find with yourself after you did it the first time, were you sort of like that as well? Like a bit when you were playing?
Yeah. So that first time I did it, I was strapping my knee.
Yeah, you strapped in.
Probably for about, I want to say, a whole season.
Yeah.
I strapped it because I wasn't mentally ready.
Yeah.
But I was physically ready and I just had itchy feet, wanted to be out there with the boys and just to be back playing rugby again, doing what you love. But I used to strap it for a year and then I slowly went down to like lighter strapping, then just strapping the inside of my knee. And then when I done it the second time, I only strapped it for maybe a month. And then I started training with no strapping. And then now I'm playing full rugby. No strapping, no nothing.
Yeah.
You think those are just called like a mental strapping?
Yeah.
Like you just strap it just for your
just for your mental.
Yeah.
There's injury straps and there's mental straps.
And then there's some guys like you that want to look cool, so they just strap it to
nothing's wrong. And then there's the one that you wear the strap on.
Bend over, hurry up. Yeah, that's true. Like mental strapping, there's injury strapping, and then there's, I'll put some tape over here just to write a name or two over here.
Come on, be honest, you're wrapping your whole RV.
Yeah, I wrap my arm and I wrap my name.
Oh, they write Kyrie.
Yeah, write all the kids' names and Charles' name, and then on this side, Pops and Tu'u, and just keep it real.
That's
keep
the one.
Yeah, that's cool. I'm the same too. I'm the same.
Do you write on your strapping?
Yeah.
Who's some of the people you put on your strapping?
So I strap this side, just straight Ainga.
Yeah.
Who I do it for, my family. Then I put my close boys on my wrist.
Yeah.
And then just anything that's going on at that time. So when Mama Balangi passed away, had Mama on there. When Adrian was going through his stuff, put Adrian up there. When Ave was going through her stuff, just put Ave on there.
Is there a new name on the wrist now?
No. Just the letter. Just the letter.
With a heart next to it.
That's one letter added every year.
Wait, 5 years and then you got
5 years. You figure it out. If you know, you know.
No, I mean, obviously we've seen, you know, the challenges you've been through, you know, on and off the field with footy and that, but what's some of the greatest achievements you've had on the field and also off the field?
Damn, greatest achievements. On the field's probably, honestly, it was just my debut for Auckland.
Yeah.
Because that was a long process, man. Yeah. Long journey. Came out of school, academy, all these injuries. And then just being able to pull on the blue and white hoops was achievement in itself.
Because that's a massive honour for like boys in rugby in Auckland, eh?
Yep. Especially growing up in the 09.
Yeah.
You get to play for your city.
Was that a dream of yours since you were young? Like playing for Auckland?
Yeah. Auckland and the Blues.
Yeah.
Those were the only two. A lot of boys say All Blacks, but I didn't really have a dream to play for the All Blacks.
Who did you debut against?
Northland.
Did you lose?
No, we won that. It was one of those ones where I was on the bench and then I think coach must have thought that we were going to suss Northland.
Yeah.
And then it was actually a good game. And then it was one of those just 10 minutes at the end. But grateful.
Grateful.
Still got a cap.
Cap. 1525.
Yeah. Tattooed on you?
Soon.
Yeah. Soon. It's coming.
It's coming.
My
1525.
What about off the field?
Off the field. Bro, I got no degree. Probably just being a loyal friend to my boys.
Yep.
Yeah.
Like, these are the boys that we all did academy together.
You want to shout them out when you finish? Like who's the...
Yeah, yeah.
Who's your group?
Just me, TJ, Aki, Isi, and Taleni.
Taleni, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Man, we're all living on different sides of the world.
Yeah.
But those are all the close boys that we all did academy together and did a lot of things together.
A lot of good things and bad things, eh? Together.
But it's good to see, like, you know, your close friends are all, like, kicking on, and you know, I'll support those dudes, man, till I die. But it's just like TJ's in Japan, Lenny's in Aussie, Aki and Isi are doing their thing over here in New Zealand, and then I'm in America. So it's just good to see all of us succeeding, in what we kind of built our friendship around. Yeah.
And then did you guys all meet through rugby, or not? Obviously,
We all met through rugby. We all went academy together straight out of school. Lenny finished the year before, but was in our class for the academy. So that's how we all met. And then me and Aki were at Ponsonby. TJ was at Pakeranga. And then Isi and Taleni were at Grammar Tech.
You spoke about how you're in the States.
Yep.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about rugby in the States and what it's like
and who you play for as well.
Yeah, who you play for, what it's like. You want to tell us a little bit about what's happening in the States?
Yeah, so I'm playing rugby in Washington, D.C. for a club called Old Glory D.C. Don't ask me what the name stands for. But
Old.
Glory, glory.
Glory, glory. But Old Glory D.C. in Washington, D.C. But, man, I tell everyone that always asks me this, rugby's different over there. Rugby's more physical in America.
Oh, yeah?
True.
Much more physical. Just then because they don't know the little details of things over here.
So they just literally just smash each other?
Literally just...
No tackle tech.
No tackle tech. It's guys that are coming from backgrounds such as, you know, football. Mainly football.
Gridiron, eh?
Used to just hammering each other. Eh?
Literally, I'm running over you or you're tackling me. Yeah. That's the mindset that they have over there. Whereas over here, we got... You know, it's a little bit more detailed, actually much more detailed, just out carries, running into holes and getting weak shoulders and whatnot.
Yeah.
Just so we can generate fast ball. But over there, I'm running over you or you're tackling me.
Like crash and bash type
of. What's that drill they do in NFL?
Shark bait.
The one where they just set the pads and they just literally one-on-one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like that. Every carry's like that. And then you got different people from different countries.
Yeah.
South Africans, RGs, New Zealanders, Aussies, all trying to, I guess, sprinkle their type of rugby in America.
Yeah.
So obviously when you play the Saffa boys, just crash and bash around the corner. Us New Zealand boys like to throw the ball around.
Yeah.
Aussies are a little bit more structured. And RG boys just like to kick a lot, kick and chase. So it's, man, I love playing over there.
Yeah.
Just because it's different every time we play a different team.
Yeah.
Like over here, you can kind of predict what people are doing.
Yeah. Mm.
Just because everyone plays the same type of rugby.
Yeah.
Whereas one week you're playing Saffas, one week you're playing Aussies, a team full of Aussies.
What was the process like of going over? Like how did that all come about of moving over and playing rugby over there? Do you want to just touch on how you got over and all that?
Yeah. So in 2021, Danny hit me up. Danny hit me up. They were looking for a midfielder. Asked if I was keen. And yeah, I just pretty much gave him the green light. Had a few chats with the coach, Andrew Douglas at the time. Good dude, New Zealander, Kiwi. And then, yeah, we just kind of agreed on a two-year deal. And I just kind of wanted to put myself in a position where I could kind of put myself in an uncomfortable situation, sorry.
Mm.
Yeah.
Get out of home, get out of New Zealand, just go explore the world for free, I guess. Yeah,
heard.
Because usually when I travel for rugby, it's like a week or two.
Yeah.
But why not go and stay in America for about 7 months of the year,
yeah,
then come back home for a bit and then go back.
But even the traveling that you do for, like, in rugby, like, you're traveling to, like, what, New York?
Yep.
LA?
Yep.
Like, those kind of places.
Yeah.
Where would you travel from here? Hamilton? Christchurch?
Taranaki.
Yeah, like, so what's the travel like over there? And obviously, we spoke about it on Tuesday. Like, these are stuff that you see in the movies.
Yeah.
Like, what's it like? Like, now this is your reality.
Man, it's crazy. Because I'm a big, like, American history type person.
Mm-hmm.
I just like knowing what happened before us.
Yeah.
And just, like, especially in Washington, D.C., man, the learning about the monuments, the Abraham Lincoln,
yeah,
Thomas Jefferson, seeing the White House. Yeah. You know, you watch movies and you see. But when I watch movies in America now, I'm just like, bro, that's home.
That's like, down the road.
That's down the road. That's 5 minutes away. And it's crazy to think like that. Because over here, you're like, damn, I want to go there.
Yeah.
Damn, I want to go to Times Square.
Because it's the capital of America, right?
Yep.
What fucking world are you from?
Bro, I'm from up north, bro. Fucking hell. You don't see that shit in movies, bro.
Who doesn't know what the capital of America is for?
Yeah.
Me.
Brody. You need to go back to Kaitaia. But I'm traveling, all that's all good. And yeah, like we spoke about the rugby and whatnot. Would you recommend, obviously more and more overseas people are joining the league.
There's a lot of New Zealand boys in your team too, eh? There's a few NZ boys.
So there was me, Danny, Penny Lasanga. He's from Bay Plenty. Carl Stewart from Taranaki. Nick Sushan from Bay Plenty. And then you got Junior Sal.
Oh, yeah.
But he's
Aussie. Kurt Baker in your school? Fobby.
Oh, yeah. Crap too, yeah. Crap. Yeah. Junior Sal?
Yeah.
Most phobious dude.
Tell us a little bit about him. Because obviously everyone knows him from League. And they see, like, he loves the camera.
Yeah, he loves
it. He loves the camera. Tell us a little bit about
him. That's my uso. Right, I always laugh, man. He's born in New Zealand, moved to Aussie, now living in England.
Yeah.
How are you a fob? English-speaking countries, how are you still broken English? But, he was a joy to play with because when he first came,
yeah,
that was his first time playing rugby union.
Oh, true. Yeah.
The first time he came in. and we used to talk a lot about details and stuff, and I think it was just hard, not hard, but it's just hard coming from
foreign language
for him to learn things that we grew up learning.
Yeah,
and he's only known downlines, back doors, bounces, you know, and we're trying to teach him a map on how to get around the field and where he should be during phase playing. But, you know, he learned in 2 years and he carved up this year, man. He went through a lot of things and he pretty much carved up.
Mm.
And now he's signed 2 years out at Kedgeley, I think. Oh. Kedgeley's the name of the team that he's at. I think it's under Super League.
Oh, he's going back to England and...
Yeah.
Is he coming back to rugby?
Nah. So that's him, yeah. But shout out to Mouso.
The broken English.
Just on that one, playing in America, would you recommend it to I guess, boys playing here in New Zealand that aren't quite getting on to, I guess, go have a crack over there and take it as a pathway to, I guess, have a break and go explore? Would you recommend it to other boys?
Highly recommend it. Example, or like a person that wasn't really kicking on in New Zealand but ended up kicking on after he came 1 year in Old Glory was Felix. Felix came to us 1 year.
He played with you here at Pontevedra.
Grammar Tech.
Yeah.
And then he wasn't really kicking on, and he was playing NPC, but he wasn't kicking on to Super, which he wanted to.
Mm.
And then he came over to Old Glory, carved up, and now he signed 3 years at Western Force.
Yeah. True.
So opportunities there, and people watch.
Yeah.
People watch MLR now. So a lot of young boys, if you're not kicking on, or I guess it's not going as planned, your plan that you have, MLR is a viable option. It's good rugby, you're training full time, and you're not, I guess, training. You might be training with the super team but not playing.
Yeah.
Whereas you can come to MLR and then you're training full time and then you're playing on the weekend.
Damn. That's once Americans like fully buy into rugby, you watch all like the technology that will come out, and
because it's a growing sport, eh? Like, yep. Do you reckon from like the first year you went, it's gotten bigger from the last season you just played?
Yeah. So America's got the 2031 World Cup.
Mm.
I reckon in the next 5 years they'll be earning close to, if not the same as, what New Zealanders are earning.
Yeah.
Oh, Kiwi boys.
Yeah.
But what do you call it? I was thinking about this the other day. Japan was like this.
Yeah.
Mm. Japan was like this. And then they bought a lot of boys, and now they've cut it down. But if you want to make money, you're going to Japan now.
Yeah.
Mm.
So America's going to be that spot soon.
Yeah. Hard.
And it's such a big country that you can have up to 20 teams and it'll still be a good comp.
Yeah.
Like over here, what we got? Is it five? Six Super Rugby teams.
Six. Five.
And we're not filling out stadiums. But
mm.
when you're over there, you can get 20 good teams, have a good competition, East and West, and man, it will grow. So I think there's a new team next year. I don't know where, sorry, but
what's the crowds in that like there? Like, you know, like you've been to, obviously with yourself and some of your close boys that play at high levels. What's the crowd like there compared to here? Like, because obviously MLR is still growing. Like, do you just play on turf?
Yeah.
Yeah, and what's the crowds in there like?
So some teams have their own grass facility.
Yeah.
Some are turf. Crowds are good. Depends where you go.
Yeah.
Old Glory's got good supporters. Win or lose, after the season we had last year to what we had this year, we've got good supporters. You know, the same faces. You go to, I haven't played up in Utah, but you go up to Utah, all the Islanders, all the Mormons up there,
oh, yeah.
They support them hard, man.
Yeah.
San Diego, they play in the, I think they had the biggest crowd this year. It was about, I want to say 12,000, 13,000.
That's a good day.
Yeah. At
is that who Ma'a plays
for? That's Ma'a and Thomas.
Do
they play for?
Yeah.
I think Americans just love sport.
Yeah. Mm.
Man, some people don't even understand it. Some people come to me up up to me after the game, and they're just like, "Man, this is the first time we've watched rugby, and we love it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, we're gonna come to all your guys' games now. Win or lose, they're gonna be there. Yeah. They're just sport fanatics
because they're not used to like no pads. Obviously, they're used to NFL and like gridiron and all that stuff, and they're doing. Exactly, you guys are doing exactly what they're doing, just no pads. So
pretty much
to them, it must be.
Yeah,
these guys are crazy. A thing like the college gridiron, like all the college football, bro. They pack out like more people than
crazy.
All Blacks games.
Crazy,
so I reckon,
100,000.
That's just college.
That's
like
college
gridiron. That's crazy.
But I was talking with one of the boys in America about this, and it's like a what do you call it? Because they got a lot of alumni.
Yeah.
So there's people who obviously just study at the university, but they feel connected to the university because that's the university that they study at.
Yeah.
Whereas people don't really have a connection to professional sports teams unless a family member plays for them or they grew up and their family's like all hard out 49ers or Patriots fans or whatever.
Because it's college rugby over there is getting like pretty up there too, eh? Because I see like the UCLA thing on TikTok and that.
Yep.
I see.
So that's one of my close boys runs at UCLA.
True.
Danny Thomas. Shout out Danny Thomas and UCLA rugby. Give me a job. Give me a job.
And a visa.
Nah, but he was, so when I was in LA with him catching up, he was saying, college rugby is starting to pick up, and it's bro, they're like head coaches earning 100K
for
American.
Because you've been in America and you would have been to some of the facilities. What's the facilities like for like college in it, like over there?
I haven't been to any college ones.
Yeah,
but I went to a high school one, and it's pretty much like a professional one over here, like a Blues. Over here,
or Warriors. That's high school.
That's high school. Ice baths, hot and cold baths.
Yeah,
full like about 20 racks of squat racks.
What kind of bro, racks?
Every
rack them up,
man. It's just crazy, man.
Yeah,
how much money is in high school, college,
and
then going into pro, obviously, but. When I was thinking that that's a high school, if I had a high school like that, had 20 racks of squat racks and all the facilities, man, I'd be there a lot.
Be a beast.
Because you see, like, those American dudes, bro, they're massive. Like, and they're built to, like, just muscle on every part of their where you can grow muscle.
Pretty much.
But on the rugby thing, where's the most, like, hostile place you've played at? Like, you know, where the fans are just crazy.
Boston.
Who's that team?
New York. New England.
Oh,
they won it this year.
Oh.
Yeah.
What? Like, tell us a bit about it,
bro. You know how New Zealanders just sit here and watch the game? Bro, those guys are in your ear. And they're probably only maybe, I want to say, 5-10 meters back from the sideline.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's how far the stands are. And you can hear them chirping at you.
Like, is it,
bro, you're a sheep shagger.
Hey, they're not wrong. They're not wrong.
Bro, running out to warm up, there was like a bunch of dudes. Me and Danny ran out at the same time. Hey, you sheep shaggers. Go back home. Bro, and it's just like.
What do you do? Just sit there and laugh.
What do you do? One, it's funny.
Yeah.
But two, you're like, who are these dudes, man?
Fuck, I want a hiding cut.
Yeah. But there was about, they packed out. I think it was around 7,000 people that came to the conference final that we played in. But it's just a good promotion for MLR rugby, seeing full stadiums and, you know. Like, I love playing in hostile environments. Like,
you thrive off tripping.
You thrive off it.
Yeah. But I kind of zone out in the game.
Yeah.
I'll zone back in when we're winning.
Yeah.
And I'll give it back.
Yeah.
But when it's like nil all or we're losing, I'm quiet.
Yeah.
Humble, quiet.
Haven't you heard Michael Jordan? That's what he says. He's all good to chirp when it's nil all. But when you're up, it's easy to chirp.
It's easy to chirp.
There's a so we'll just talk about like some pressures. Obviously, sports is a pressure environment. Can be a pressure, a lot of pressure and even life, like we had spoken about. And you just spoke about it there, like having like the crowds, and we spoke about it earlier with expectations. How did you deal with, like, how do you deal, or do you want to tell us a bit about some of your pressures and how you dealt with some of the pressures?
On field?
Yeah, on field, and then maybe off the field?
Either.
Yeah, yeah. Either.
The last two years, the pressures for me have been being a foreigner, playing in the MLR, because you're only allowed a certain amount of foreigners.
So playing or playing, signed?
Playing. Yeah. You can sign as many as you want. But you're only allowed 10 foreigners in the 23 each week. So when Americans see you, they expect you to, you know, play like you've played your whole life.
Yeah.
But you can have an off game here and there. But like the pressures of, even from the coaches, you guys are the foreigners, you guys need to carry this team.
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, we can only do so much, that we need some help as well.
There's 14 other people on the field.
There's 14 other dudes, or there's 13 other non-foreigners that can, you know, help us. But those have been the big pressures that I've felt the last 2 years, just being a foreigner and kind of us foreigners having to put the, not put the team on our shoulders, but kind of take the brunt of things when shit hits the fan.
Yeah.
So when we're winning, he's doing well. When we're losing, bro, what are you doing? Like, we might not even bring you back next year.
Yeah.
Like, that was a chat last year after we only won. We went 3-13. They were like, well, I was set because I had signed 2 years.
Yeah.
But a lot of the boys were kind of on the chopping block. And then I was just lucky that one of the coaches stayed on and kind of still believed in us. And then we came back and we made the conference finals. So give me the bag.
Where's the bag, man? Where's the bag?
Give me the bag.
Because there'll be a lot of pressure,
man.
There'll be a lot of pressure for you, especially because they're signing news and they've brought you over from another country to come in.
Exactly.
Move you in and everything.
Yeah. And that's like a, I guess the only way I can kind of put it into perspective is if an All Black goes back and plays NPC and you see.
Yeah, hard.
Like, people on the couch that are commenting, he's old, like, what's he doing?
Yeah.
Mm.
And Aki went through that a lot.
Yeah.
Where he was, you know, and I had seen it. When you go back to NPC as an All Black, you're the one that's supposed to make things happen.
Yeah, yeah.
You're supposed to play a mean game, you know, rather than, he's just playing NPC, he'll just do his role within the team to help the team.
Now it's like a whole, you better be the best on the field.
Exactly. Mm. And that's the kind of, I'm not saying we're the All Blacks over there, but we're the foreigners.
Yeah.
We're the ones that have played rugby our whole life. Those guys just learned it maybe 3-4 years before.
Yeah.
So we're trying to teach them at training how to do things. And then we're trying to help coach them as well.
Yeah.
And then we're trying to also make sure that we're prepared to put our best foot forward on Saturday or Sunday.
Mm.
So that's been the biggest on-field pressure the last 2 years.
You just spoke about how you've made the conference finals this year and even the year before about only winning 3 games. And I know last year when you come back you played in the Ponsonby final too. How does Willie deal with losses?
Are you a sore loser?
I was.
Yeah.
Not so much now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you say you were, like, what do you mean?
Like, I just
Ika, slakangin.
Not Ika, nah. Just wouldn't talk to anyone. Just sit in my own thoughts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What could I have done better? What were the moments that I could have helped out or helped change?
Yeah.
But I actually did that once this year.
What?
I got Ika. That was a game against Toronto.
Like if we're all on the same team and you lost and we lost, like, are you the type, like,
that'll just sit there in the changing room
and just chill? Or you're the type, like I used to be back in the day, like, I used to be like, FUs are all useless.
Yeah.
Like, I was a bad sore loser. Are you like that? Or
I'm just sit
there and just chill?
Sit in my own locker, just move all the way back. Yeah. No one can see me. And I'll just sit there, be the last to shower, last to get up. I'll just sit there and just think about it. But I move on quickly, though. I move on quick.
Are we having a beer together, like, even though we've lost, or is it one of those, like, you'll go your way, I'm going my way?
I'm going home.
It depends. Like, that Toronto game, one of the boys, like, we had previewed the whole week, just chop tackle. We should have won that game. We ended up drawing. And I was just real mad at him. But and then I didn't talk to him for like a whole week. not a week, maybe a couple of days.
Yeah.
And I was just sitting there like, bro, what is he doing? Like, but then, you know, you just got to, you always come back to they're doing their best as well.
Yeah.
So that's why I always sit in my own thoughts and I just think about other people. But I deal with losses better now. It's a grateful thing again, just moving on. When we lost at Gallagher.
Yeah.
Mm.
Man, that was probably a tough one. But it was one of the young boys that gave away that penalty.
Yeah.
Shout out to Caleb.
Name drop.
Little, so. Nah. Bro, I remember that play very vividly.
Yeah. Mm.
And I haven't watched the game back since. It's come on Sky Sport.
What happened?
Does that live rent-free? Does that live rent-free in your mind, like that game?
Not anymore.
Not anymore?
I don't really care anymore, but... So we were, they had a line, they got a penalty, they kicked to the line, and it was a line out. And we were down, I think we were up one. We were up one. And then I just had a feeling, man. And we were standing at the line, we were back 10. And I just remember yelling to all the boys on the, no one go offside, just stay on. They caught the line out, they came down, Bernie just shot up. And then, pretty much gave away the penalty. They chipped it though. I didn't know what they were thinking. They were trying to chip and chase or something. But that's what gave away the penalty. And then I just remember we went into the changing room and he was crying. And that's when I was like, at that point I was like, there's nothing we can do about it. Yeah. Like it's done and gone. But I don't know if that was his first Gallagher final.
Did he need to rush? Like did he rush for a reason or just panicked?
To be fair, we were in the 22. They were in our 22.
Yeah.
So, but we were trying to put pressure, but it is what it is. But just dealing with, back to dealing with losses, like he was crying and stuff. And like I just remember standing up in front of all the boys just saying, man, like we had a real young team, all mostly under 25, all still young. And I was just like, you guys will be back here.
Yeah.
Like, just know how this feels. Know the meaning of what the Gallagher means to the club and the club means to you.
Yeah.
And you guys will be back here. Mm-hmm. So don't dwell on it too much. Be angry, be whatever. But once you leave this changing room and I turn on the music,
God.
We're drinking.
You heard.
Like, we're drinking to celebrate the season.
Mm. Have you won one before?
Two. Yeah.
Not bad, eh?
Not bad. Back to back.
Two out of what? How many goes have you had?
That was my third one.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. So we won the first one against Varsity, second one against Marist,
yeah,
and then that one against Manukau. But
that was supposed to be the biggest party in Central, mate.
It was, because then you guys won.
Yeah. We had spoken about
almost,
it.
Almost spoke it into existence, but that's why I came and drank with you guys on Sunday.
Oh, Willie's here. Bro, imagine if both teams had won, bro. Central would have been
pumping.
It would have been silly, eh?
Would have been a
and we're hoping week. Because we're actually our finals were the same time, and we had played. We were at Mount Smart. These guys were at Eden Park, and I remember after the game we'd come to the changing rooms and we checked the phone, and it was Wise. Hey, Wise had kicked the goal to be in the lead, and we're like, yeah, fuck, they've won, we're on. And then one of our girl mates rang us, and Louie, she rang us and she was like, Monaco won, Monaco, because they were going for Monaco, and we're just like, hey, yo, shit, we just seen the score. Ponsonby won. They're like, oh, nah. They got a kick on the hooter, and we're just like, oh, fuck.
Remember, we for ages, we were like, nah, yo, shit.
Yeah.
Then we watched it on IG.
Yeah,
you know, in stadiums the reception's bad.
Yeah, yeah.
But so we couldn't. We're all on our phones, and then we saw him kick the winning goal.
Yeah,
that penalty goal, and we were like, "What?"
We're just like, "Whoa!"
Yeah, it was tough, but like, props to Manukau, man.
Yeah,
I think Auckland Rugby's needed a Southside team to win for years.
Yeah,
for years, just to help out Auckland Rugby and bring people back to, because a lot of those Southside boys go to. You know, come to different clubs.
Yeah.
Mm.
Not so much Ponsonby, but like College Rifles or East Team Pekaranga or something like that. Grammar Tech.
Eden.
But having a South team, win it is good for Auckland Rugby, because then, you know,
But how many
those boys stay home?
How many buses did they roll up in?
I think it was like four. Four buses maybe.
They had a big parade and stuff and everything, out there.
Yeah. So that's why it's good for South to win. Has the Southside team won?
Not an ages.
League
Cora.
The Fox. Oh yeah, Cora, 2016.
They're not South, eh?
Cora was 2016.
There's a funny story though. The Gallagher Shield actually ended up with us at one point. Eh? When was it? The Sunday or the next weekend. Yeah. We're at Waipiti and Tawara, his boys with Kane, and he rocked up and hey, fuck the Shield's here. We're just like, yeah, mean.
Yeah. We've got into a bit of about rugby and whatnot. What's life outside of rugby for you? Obviously, you're back in New Zealand now.
Yep.
What's life outside of rugby looking for you? Like, what are your plans? What are you doing now? And obviously, off season from America. Like, what's life like outside of rugby for you?
So back here, doing youth work.
Yeah.
Out at a school out west, and then that's kind of what I enjoy, just hanging out with, helping out kids, and whether it be coaching or. Youth work or whatever, but hopefully in the next 5 years I want to get into coaching, whether that be here in New Zealand or over in America. Kind of want to get into coaching because I just enjoy just helping people out. And never know, I might end up being a copper. What's funny?
Arrest yourself.
But yeah, coach will be first, but
yeah,
if I do come home and I need to settle at home, cop's always an option on the table.
You've always wanted to be a cop?
Yeah, since I was young.
Yeah,
just always wanted to. It's kind of the community thing, just helping out the community. And but if I can and everything goes to plan, hopefully be a coach somewhere. Whether it be whatever, head coach, backs coach.
Heads coach.
Coming to play for Point Chev.
Give that a little dig.
But that will be the plan.
So coach first, police officer if
things fall through.
How do you keep yourself well mentally, and where do you see yourself in the next 5 years?
Just catching up with people. I think it was on Tuesday. I was telling you,
Johns is a special place to catch up to with the boys. Heart, hey,
2016, I've been going there. Man.
You're the one that actually introduced me to going there, and I think I've been there ever since.
Yeah, it was just passed down this way.
And now we see more and more Islanders.
When I used to go,
no Islanders, no one knew about Johns, no one. But Johns is a special place to connect with people, and you know, just have a few laughs and. See how people's week's going, but that's my way of kind of reconnecting with people and catching up and seeing how they are and kind of just telling them how my week's going. But that's how I kind of
training,
stay mentally
fitness, like gym and that, like work, like that another way, or
that's physical. Yeah, that's physical.
Yeah,
sometimes it helps me.
Yeah,
but not the most. If you look at my rig, not the best. Haven't got the best rig. But then again, I don't really like doing things on my own. Like, I couldn't go to the gym. I can go, but I don't really like going to the gym by myself. I like, you know, the chirping to someone and talking smack with the boys at the gym and just catching up. That's another way I usually, like last year, I did that, catching up with a lot of boys. Wise Guy and TJ, when we used to go to the gym every day and just talk smack and...
Do more talking than training, eh?
Yeah.
I think that's elbows.
Hard.
But it's just a good feeling, you know, and then John's is always a good place to catch up with people for coffee and whatnot, and then, but that's kind of how I stay mentally well. When I'm back, it's just, catching up and having a few beers with people.
And what about in 5 years? Like, where do you see yourself? Or what do you want to be doing?
Still playing?
Coaching?
Wait, what? Oh, yeah. Still playing. I'll be, 33?
Still young, mate. Still young.
Yeah, hopefully still playing in America. Married.
Have a kid. Was that too much?
My man. Yeah, my man. Hey. I read that also.
Five years, five letters.
Yeah, funny that, because when me and him did his, he goes, where do you see your self, you know, in 5 years? And I had nothing, bro. I had nothing in my head. And I go, oof, settle down, man, settle down. We just started laughing.
You just need to grow up. You just get
to the point where you just had enough.
Yeah, just had enough of it, but just need to grow up. And
kids?
Oh, if God blesses me with some, yeah.
How many you want? Like, if you could, you know?
3 or 4. That'll be my number.
Yeah.
Hopefully all boys.
You don't want all boys. You at least want one girl.
Yeah. Maybe she can be the youngest.
Yeah, hard. Definitely.
3 older boys and then one.
So married, hopefully still playing, 3 or 4 kids.
That's not too much to ask.
Still playing in America, mate. Definitely not too
much. Hopefully we're getting banked by then.
But more finals.
Yeah. But that's pretty much, yeah, hopefully in 5 years I'll be doing that.
Mm.
And then still kind of be coming home and visiting. And everyone's still sweet.
Yeah.
Everyone's still good.
Fuck. Sounds like a
deadly plan, man.
Yeah, sounds like a deadly plan. And not too much to ask for.
Not too much to ask.
Simple. Something simple.
Yeah. Simple.
So, well, hopefully we'll speak that into existence.
We'll manifest it, eh? Manifest it. Got to manifest it.
It's not like the plane, but
yeah,
not like the series.
Yeah, not like the series. Nah, thank you very much, man. Like, obviously, we got to speak about some of the stuff that we were able to touch on, and obviously get like your story and some of the stuff that you've been through. But I know you personally, so. Hearing some of the stuff that you've spoken about that maybe I haven't heard before.
Yeah.
For me, like that's what I wanted to do this for. And that's what is special to me, is being able to hear people's stories and letting them speak about it, so that you know, other people, it might inspire or might motivate other people. Because we know that, you know, all it takes is someone to understand that we are all human. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And like, we all have feelings, we all go through like emotional stuff and whatnot. It's just, obviously we all deal with it differently. And I just want to, thank you very much for giving us the time and day to come along and jump on the podcast. And I'll give it to Broads before I hand it over to you, and you can wrap it up for us if that's all good.
Yeah. No. I wanted to ask a question.
Go ahead, mate.
A hot take.
Go ahead.
Just a little discussion.
Yeah.
Fire.
Because I heard it in America.
Far away, mate.
Do you think sports is modern day slavery?
Ooh, that's a good question.
You know,
do you think sports is modern day slavery?
Are we talking about just sports in general, or are we talking about professional sports?
Professional.
I think to an extent.
That's some expensive slavery.
So I think to it, because it takes so much of your time. You know, you have the, I guess, boys have those days where you wake up and go, oh, fuck, I've got to go to training.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Oh, I've got to go to work.
Yeah.
Rich
white people sitting up on top.
Yeah.
Mm. Watching.
Like gladiators. Hey.
Mm.
Yep.
Yep.
And you have to, do it. You have to do it, or else.
You don't get paid.
Yeah, you don't get paid. You can't provide. Thinking about it now, like what you just said, is
I agree. Contract talk,
yo,
is like putting someone up on the pedestal.
Yeah,
you know, when they put them up and they sell them.
Yeah.
So I learned this when I went to the African American Museum. So they have all the, you know, the stuff over there in Washington D.C. And you learn about slavery, and that they, you know, they put you up there. Oh, this guy's going for
X amount of dollars.
He can speak this language. He's a good cook. He can pick cotton real fast. Stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's like, you know, when you're sending out contracts.
Yeah.
So the more you have, he's this tall. Yo.
He's this fast. Yeah. You know, combines in that.
Yeah.
He can kick. He can catch.
Yeah.
I agree.
They're all putting themselves on show. And there's predominantly white people. Or.
It is.
Yeah, it is.
Predominantly white people up there. Scouting them.
Yeah.
Mm.
come and play for us or come and work for us.
So modern sport is a modern day slavery.
That's 100%.
How many Bailangis in the NBA?
Fuck all.
Fuck all.
But how many of them in the front office?
Exactly.
All of them.
Shit.
But at the back, playing basketball on the court, it's all the African Americans.
Mm.
But in the front, you barely find African American. Well,
you could say rugby.
How many islanders? Yeah, that's rugby and league.
Yeah, exactly.
What's the percentage in league?
I think like 60% is all Polynesian.
That's, you know, but if you look at the NRL, like all teams, like in there, like 25, predominantly they're all islanders.
Mm.
Yeah. And then you look through all their like development grades, they're all islanders.
All islands.
Like I agree. Like it is modern day slavery. Mm. Now they're just getting paid well for it. Yeah.
Mm.
It's an expensive piece of slavery. But like you said, like if you take the movie Gladiator, there's always someone up top watching down on the arena.
Yeah.
And predominantly Bailangi. And they're basically scouting the best talent that they can find.
Mm.
And then the manager, he's the person putting the player up here saying, look, my player can do this. He deserves this much.
Yeah.
And then they were like, I agree. You're on my team. If you don't perform, guess what? You're out.
Mm.
Like, but that's exactly.
Guess I'm a slave then.
A rich one, eh?
Hey, as long as the bag's coming in, eh?
Give me the money. Yeah. Wow, I never even thought of that, like, in that sense. That's true. Very true.
Yeah. We'll have it was just a random thought.
I appreciate it. That's something that...
I think we can ask...
other people.
Athletes that we can, you know, get on that question.
Because, if you don't do your job, you're getting kicked to the curb.
Oh, yeah, 100%. Like, it was...
You're getting contract cut up.
Yeah.
And if you and if you break the laws of your contract, you're getting kicked.
Mm. You're not doing your job properly, you're getting killed.
That, or put it like this, like we had spoken about getting someone on the podcast that's contracted. We won't say his name.
Yeah, yeah.
And because he's contracted.
Yeah.
Because he's a no filter follower. Like he's a guy with no filter, he loves to talk shit. Yeah, he'll say what's on his mind.
What's on his mind.
Mm.
But because he's contracted, he, like, if we were to get him on the podcast, he wouldn't be able to say, like, speak how he normally does.
Yeah.
So that's all. Yeah,
NDA type.
Yeah. Like, you know, just because he's contracted, he can't go into, like, stuff that, but if we had our general conversation, he'd speak freely about.
Yeah, yeah.
But because this will probably go up on social media and all of that stuff, and then might go back to who he plays for, like, he won't
can't
be able
affect the club.
Exactly. He won't image. Be able to speak or say whatever he wants. Like what he normally does.
And we don't want that drama.
Yeah. We don't want that.
Not yet.
Yeah, exactly. So appreciate it. Also, do you wanna close us out and give us say your last bits or
first just thank you for having me, man. Pleasure to be on the Breaking Bread podcast.
Yeah.
With a bunch of
breadwinners.
Breadwinners. But just for people out there, just don't let comparison be the thief of joy.
Mm-hmm.
Enjoy life. Enjoy what you do. As long as you're better today than you were yesterday, then that's all you can ask for. Be grateful. Love your family. Love your friends. Mm. Keep your circle small. Just go get it, man.
And love,
go after it.
And love your...
We're clipping that. we're clipping that. Hey, that's inspiring, man. But now, but honestly, thank you for coming on, hearing your journey and you sharing your journey. I think that's why we started this, was to help people, not just athletes, but people, be a platform for people to share their stories and their journeys, because you never know who's on the other side of the screen listening. So,
100.
Thanks, Oos. We really appreciate it. We wish you nothing but the best for the future.
No worries.
We hope you get the bag.
Yeah.
And then you come to John's and shout us to you.
Again. Thanks for the US dollars.
But nah, thank you, Oos. And, looking forward to connecting with you off the screen as well. So,
let's get ready to rumble!
Willie Talataina.
Yes, sir.
What's that on that beat? Oh.
Did it.